Here's one, then. If you could have any car in the world, anything, absolutely anything, what would it be?
Easy, Porsche 911.
What, straight up?
Yeah, nothing touch it.
The engine's in the wrong place.
What's in the car, isn't it?
What about a Ferrari?
Well, Ferrari's all right, as long as you've got a highly qualified team of mechanics and a private security firm.
Lamborghini.
Rod Stewart.
Point taken. But I can't agree with you on the Porsche, though. Everyone would think you was one of them yuppies.
Yeah, no, but your Porsche, right? Looks beautiful, drives beautiful. Nothing up, touch a Porsche 911, definitely.
The Porsche 911. Of all the cars in all the world, few evoke the same sort of polarity of emotion as the air-cooled Porsche. Because, you know, the world is divided. The one half thinks it's the motoring equivalent of the Antichrist. They loathe it with a Calvinistic hatred, while the other, well, they just say it's the next best thing to inflatable Pamela Anderson dolls. But whatever your position, there is one thing you can never, ever deny the 911. Never has one car given so much fun to so many for so long. Time long ago when you couldn't buy a 911 in Britain, so intrepid enthusiasts were forced to journey to foreign parts.
Ah, Herr Blenkinsop.
Hello, dear boy. Terribly sorry I'm late. A bit choppy coming across the channel.
You must not apologize. You are only 12 and a half minutes late. I myself was 3 minutes late. I completely miscalculated the time it would take me to get here from Stuttgart. However, we are here now, and so is this. Mr. Blenkinsop, may I introduce you to the Porsche 911?
I say, it's a bit of a hoover.
Hoover?
Very useful for picking up bits of fluff, don't you know?
Yeah, very good. Now, if I may show you...
A study in Prussian perfection, the 911 didn't have a curve out of place. Compared to gentlemanly Austin Healey's and E-types, it looked ruthlessly modern. The Germans had taken the romanticism out of the sports car and replaced it with something completely new, aggression. And driving a 911 for the first time is one of life's defining moments.
You will drive now.
Oh, right you are. Right.
Yet this wasn't the world's first encounter with the Porsche name. The firm's roots lie not with cars, but with war. A certain Austrian house painter enlisted the engineering expertise of the Porsche studio for the fascist war machine. Ferdinand Porsche was commissioned by the Nazi Party to design transport for the masses. The result was the Volkswagen Beetle. The strength-through joy car could carry four adults, do 100 kilometers an hour, 35 to the gallon, and all for 999 Reichsmarks, 90 quid. The Führer was delighted. So, what with the lucrative contract to design Tiger and Mouse tanks, plus V12 aero engines and the odd bit of modification to the V1 flying bomb, the Porsche Empire finished the war in rude financial health, which Ferdinand's son, Dr. Ferry Porsche, was to put to good effect. What he came up with was the first car to carry the family name, the 356 of 1950. Copying the Beetle's rear-engine layout, the 356 had titanium build quality, sprightly performance and a fine handling balance. The Stuttgart Screamer captivated enthusiasts all over the world and sold nearly 78,000 units. In 63, Ferry Porsche's son gave the 356 some serious tweaks and tucks, choosing the Frankfurt Motor Show to debut the so-called 901. But Peugeot had already claimed copyright on all car numbers with a zero in the middle. So the 911 was born. $3,000 bought you an air-cooled, six-cylinder, two-litre boxer engine that could crack 60 in a little over 8 seconds and max out at a brisk 130 miles an hour. The world marvelled that the 911 could be almost as quick as an E-Type, yet have an engine only half the size.
I say, I'm happy. What a luck. I do some racing at home, you know.
May I suggest, Mr. Blenkinsop, that you read our hints to drivers, which have been compiled specifically for the owners of new Porsche 911, Mr. Blenkinsop!
Of course, putting the engine in the back meant there were always some handling histrionics. Lift off the gas at the wrong moment on a corner, and you'd destroy an entire suburb before you came to rest.
So, you like our car, Mr. Blenkinsop? Mr. Blenkinsop? Mr. Blenkinsop?
But for every go-faster Herbert who scared himself witless, there was a racer who sampled success. You see, Porsche's racing record is unparalleled. The 356 may have won at Le Mans, but the 911's track performance is simply staggering. Since 63, it's clocked up over 20,000 race wins and been victorious in every major motorsport competition it's entered. The 911 is a master racer. And this is the finest racer of them all, a 152-mile-an-hour homologation special stripped of every luxury. Few cars in the world offer the same amalgam of balance, alacrity and pure poise. The 72 Carrera RS 2.7.
You could use it on the road, you could go shopping in it, you could literally take it, then drive it to the circuit, and at that stage, probably win an FIA race with it and then drive it home again.
Well, when the Carrera RS first came out, it was really quite a revelation.
You can take a lot of liberties with it.
You never feel like the back end's doing something different to the front.
It was so easy and controllable and such good fun to actually drive sideways, but that wasn't the quick way around.
The whole car moves as a piece. I won't mention any names, but you can drive any British sports car of that era, and the whole thing was shaking about and doing different things. The front wheels were doing different to the back, and you were sort of moving around in the car.
I raced a 911 in 1972 and won the European Championship with it.
I won 16 out of 16 races. I lost a race once to Chris Meek, who went out and bought a load of tyres to stop Porsche winning.
And all the modifications that we tried out on that car were really incorporated into this, the 1973 road car. And that's the way Porsche always worked. So that the customer for the road cars always benefited from the racing development.
Well, I've had a love affair with Porsche since I was 9 years of age. In 74, I became a Formula One driver. I drove for a company called Hexagon of Highgate, and at that time they were Porsche dealers. I just wanted to have a Porsche Carrera. They had one, a black one, PGF 911L. I decided I wanted that car, and I traded in a Ford Granada, and I drove out of the garage with a black 911 RS Touring, which I have to this day. To me, it's the best Porsche that's ever been produced. I think I'm very, very lucky indeed to own an RS Touring. They're just the most amazing cars.
By the middle 70s, the 911 had become an object of desire. For well-heeled Johnny-come-latelys, there was only one model, the Turbo of 1974. Costing twice as much as a stock 911, it could scream from 0 to 100 in 12 seconds and knock on the door of 160 miles an hour. The Turbo did two things for Porsche. It made the maker of one of the fastest machines in the world and cemented forever the 911's reputation as a little something for the weekend.
Hey, funky chick, looking for a lift?
How far are you going, man?
On the way, hopefully. Jump in.
Groovy!
Oh,
This was the first ever production sports car with a turbocharger, and Porsche's motorsport experiences were yet again responsible for a racy little number.
You got an amazing car, man.
Yeah, you have to handle her like a beautiful woman. Treat her roughly, she can bite back.
You really know how to handle a car, don't you?
You haven't seen me handle a beautiful woman yet.
Oh, well.
Oh, I saw her.
But in 1977, Porsche did something very bizarre. They tried to kill off the 911 and replace it with the 928.
The way the story is told at boozy bars around Germany is that it took the Americans to turn around and say, actually, the 911 is the car that everybody wants. And think about all those sports car manufacturers over the years that have forgotten racing, have forgotten the real heritage of what they're producing, and have tried to produce a car for a different market. They've all failed. And Porsche came very close to failing.
Luckily, Stuttgart saw sense and reinvented the 911 in the form of the 3.2 Carrera of 1983.
The 928 never became a replacement because it was never as good as the 911.
And the new Carrera was even better, faster, more economical, and much easier to drive. The popularity brought problems. Porsche was about to get tangled up in a decade they'd rather forget. Relax, don't you rest. In the 80s, a new breed of owner appeared. Stockbrokers and accountants who had never before drawn a rebellious breath.
Duncan! Yeah, hi.
Kieran! Yeah, top month, Kay. Yeah, great bonus.
Yeah, me too. Gonna blow it on a bloody Porsche.
Me too.
Superb. Turbo.
Cabrio.
Superb.
Ah, excelente, senor. Cabrio.
Turbo.
Mine.
Lovely.
Suddenly, all sorts of people were wandering into Porsche showrooms. The 911 had become a badge of rank. Enthusiasts stood back and watched in horror as their masterpiece became a lifestyle accessory. And as any broker or fund manager will tell you, when an insatiable demand tears away at a limited supply, there's only one way for prices to go, and that's up.
Revs a go-go, baby.
Can't wait to drive it.
We heard at one point a certain dealer sold a new Porsche for almost three times its retail value.
One guy who was hyping up the market by putting in false ads in the Sunday Times, he was putting in ads for cars at £120,000, and these cars didn't exist. When people rang up, he could just simply say, sorry, they're sold. He might have had one or two cars. When the car was finally sold, he was able to create a huge profit from cars that he might have invested £25,000-£30,000 in and selling them for over £100,000.
One impatient city broker even shelled out $250,000 to beat the queue for a new 911 Turbo, a car that should have cost $60,000.
Any time a car was used to depict that era, it was almost always a 911.
They slightly distorted the facts, and I feel that they tried to associate that with the yuppie period, and very unfairly.
I don't think that it did the mark very much good. It really became absolutely associated with the raging consumerism of the 80s.
And it became less of a design icon and more of a status symbol.
The press, the media, made a lot of it, yuppies in 911s, but we felt that the ones that we saw ended up driving other manufacturers' cars, or the 944s.
The guys were given as a bonus mainly 944s.
Red! Smashing. Shiny.
Lovely.
Turbo.
Gear stick.
Yeah.
Could I help you, gentlemen?
911's not really my bag. Got any 944s?
Yeah, 944.
Yeah, smashing.
Lovely.
To rescue their ailing image, Porsche went back to what they do best, engineering. The 198-mile-an-hour four-wheel-drive bi-turbo 959 won the Paris-Dakar rally twice and taught them that when it comes to Porsches, technology is all. The four-wheel-drive Carrera 4 of 89 took the 911 into a new era. Quieter and more forgiving, it was the start of an evolutionary process that would turn the 911 from a hard-charging sports car into an urbane grand tourer. generation 911, the 993 was a technological funfair and the most civilized and sure-footed yet. Porsche said the 911 wasn't growing old, it was just growing up. Which brings us to the current 911, the 996. A water-cooled engine, six-speed gearbox, 174 miles an hour, yet still as beautiful as a blank check.
Well, I think it is certainly to do with the shape of the car that it's achieved the design icon status. That this car has developed over 30, 35 years, and it's just gradually changed, and a brilliant idea in the first place has been fine-tuned year after year after year, and still has the integrity of the original idea. I think also that the fact that that it's connected to the Beetle, the Volkswagen Beetle, also gives it that sort of particular status of being something that is really interesting to designers, that you can do a poor man's version and a rich man's version of the same idea. The interior fittings, of course, have changed from something extremely simplistic in the early days into something that is perhaps slightly too luxurious for my taste today.
And that's the rub. The 996 may be one of the world's most coveted cars, but does its evolutionary revolution still make it a proper 911?
I mean, this one I think is an absolutely beautiful car, but it's, I think it's become a little too bonfire of the vanities for my taste. It's too comfortable and it hasn't got that sort of rugged austerity that they used to.
I'm not sure that they know what they're trying to gain, but I think what they've lost is an engine that barked and a car that performed in a particular way.
This has become grand touring, grand confort.
It still does all the things that a 911 did, but it's lost that edge.
35 years on and we're left with a 911 in name only, a sophisticated boulevard cruiser that ignores its sports car heritage. The real 911 is no more. And the world is definitely a poorer place.
If you own a Ferrari, you'll always walk around with a bit of that car in your hand, and you'll always be trying to fix it back. The great thing about a 911 is that every time you shut the door, it will fit in the right place and lock.
It's been a unique motor car in the history of motor cars. It's something so totally different to anything else, and I think it's probably the finest sports car ever made.
Well, I think they are addictive. You know, it's rather like a nice gin and tonic, that where would you be without it?